to show you a little bit about this website project that I'm working on. And I'm just going to kind of power through this. We're not going to watch the whole thing. Maybe I just want to talk about it. Maybe I'll get started. And I'm going to hope that this like is functional for me to do. But I think, oh dear, so I'm already going back. So. Okay.
Do you have to swipe it?
No, but I'm trying to get this video to play, and we messed with this earlier, and there was like a secret, but I don't know what it is. Sometimes it doesn't work. Okay, so while that plays, I'm working on this video project by LingUpDis.com. That's supposed to be a resource for teachers and parents and students. So we have some songs that we've written. It has stuff for young kids. It has resources for older kids. And I'll just skip through this. This is a little song I wrote first. For working in the frog, cat, 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 picking up stuff. So that's a little frog song I wrote. So there's some stuff. I'm going to zip through this. How do I do this? Okay, so, and I'm sorry I'm down in front of this. So basically, this is my colleague Phyllis. So we made this website and we're working on this. It's a big project, and I'll be interested in some feedback from you afterwards. And I'm going to do this really fast, so probably I'm going to gloss over some things. So we basically are trying to find ways to make development from the early levels holistic, so that there's technical and musical and physical and oral and everything kind of happening at the same time as you develop. So that it's, and sometimes in development, if you isolate these things when they're younger, you get control over them, and then eventually, of course, we want to be holistic, intelligent practitioners. But the question is, how do we get there? So this is part of our website is geared towards the beginning level and young kids, and part of it is geared towards pedagogy and help for young teachers and maybe parents to kind of understand concepts. So, how do I do this swipe? Okay, so we have this holistic approach. We're looking for physical fluidity, mental focus, all of that. We have a pedagogy part where we explain pedagogical principles of various things, and we have videos of some of the exercises that we did today, and it's by topic. And then we have over 700 videos up there of various things, working with older students, working with younger students. Some of the videos are, actually working with the students. Some of them are actually guided practice videos where a young kid could actually practice with the video. We find that a lot of what's going on in the homes is like either parents fighting with their kids or not being involved with their kids. And a little bit, there's a part of me that actually kind of hates this concept, to be honest, but what I found is a little bit of a child, it's like doing a yoga tape. You know, you're in front of the video and the kid watching something, you know, that you've already said to them at home has some help. So, the pedagogy part, we're looking for it to have some resources for teachers and sequencing. And even some of my teen students are working with this now. And so let's say I do a vibrato exercise with them in the lesson. I always find that then the next week I'm saying the same thing, and the next week I say the same thing. And now I can say, now go watch this video, and they can remember better what I've said and to try to do it again and get some ideas. So it's helping with that. So we have things for students and teachers, and there are a bunch of free resources and so on and so forth. So the pedagogy stuff is sort of by topic, and I think some of these things are in your handout. If you want to kind of get your handout out, there's going to be a couple things I'm going to refer to that might be in there. So here's the pedagogy overview, and that might be in your handout, actually, just to give you an idea. So we have by topic, basic setup. I don't know if you can read this. Left hand, bow arm, musical integration. That's where we're, like I've said before, you can talk about bow, you can talk about this, but then we're going to try to put some examples of how to integrate into actual excerpts of music and repertoire. And then, like, if you dig down into shifting, we've categorized in a way to help people see sequences. So prerequisites, foundations, scales and exercises, and musical integration. So that, like, let's say you had a student needed some help with shifting, they're not a beginner, you could go into the prerequisites and see, well, is there anything there that might be valuable for them to go back and do? Or, you know, can they do everything here before we go on? Or, I just need another vibrato exercise for continuous vibrato, and oh, here's one. You know, so it can be used in a variety of ways. So here we have vibrato and shifting detail, and this might be in your handout. So for now, these are pretty much all the videos we have, which of course we're always adding them. So it's kind of by topic, and it can give some ideas.
Another thing is, so here's just an example. Is to do some shadow work.
Okay, I'm going to skip this because we actually did this today.
We're going into,
so this would be an example where I'm doing what we just did.
And
oh,
I have that.
Here's a little vibrato. So that's an example of like a pre vibrato exercise. So that's an example of like a continuous vibrato exercise, and a lot of them, I have my former students, you know, who are in college now, come back and do this with us. And I'm just going to move on. So the pedagogy part, the idea is that that part is by topic. So if you, as a teacher or a teenager, have something you're working on, you may get some ideas on some things, and we're always adding things in. We also have a part that's kind of by repertoire, and we'll get to that in a second. Then we're also doing sort of a method where we've spent a lot of time making sequences at the very, very early levels with this kind of concept of being holistic. And at the very beginning levels, our idea is to have kind of a very articulated sequence of what to practice when, and then as they get older, it becomes less specific. So we start with a sequence of repertoire that we think works pretty well, but philosophically, I also, like I've said, no one set of repertoire is ever going to be perfect. So my concept about this is that this is a pretty good sequence. And if you're teaching beginners, you might get some value out of some of these pieces or some of these ideas. You may have other pieces you like to teach. You might think you don't need some of them. And every teacher should feel free to kind of figure out what they can use and what's helpful and not to you. So I'm not dogmatic about this. You'll see it's a sequence, but I'm not dogmatic philosophically. I'm like, you know, this might be helpful. If you've never taught, if you just do this, it'll probably, you'll get some good results. But the more you teach, the more you pull your own thing. And I view that, because I do a lot of teacher training, the same as my students on the instrument. You don't want to end up playing exactly like your teacher, exactly, sounding or whatever. You eventually are going to make your own way. I view artistry of teaching the same way, that you're going to get ideas from all kinds of different places or methods or people or whatever, and once you start really working on your own, you'll pull and pull things in your own personality and your own history, and blend into your own artist teaching. So that's my philosophy on it, even though this looks like kind of over control. That's not really what I think. So we have different levels, and the beginning to twinkle. And the first set is like 15 songs, and I think that might be in your handout, a little list of the songs. And they start with pizzicato with high dad, and then they add open strings, and then they add fingers. Each level, every song has all of these things. A warm-up, and this warm-up is actually just physical. It's not even, you know, physical warm-ups. Some of it might be with creating the instrument, and some of it not. Skills and drills, which is just sports stuff. Musicianship, you'll see. Look and listen, you'll see. Working out a piece. Performance practice with piano, music appreciation, and a concert at the end. So I'll show you how this looks. So what we're gonna do, and I think this might be in your handout, is a say road trip, and you see this, this is only on one page. This is like the practice chart for this week. This is the fifth level. This is a piece I wrote, and it's really amazing. It has two notes in it. This is because I wanted to do open strings and not cross at the tip. So this will be an example at one level of what you're going to practice that week. Okay, that's the song. This is the practice chart, and you can see all the different aspects. That's a little practice chart. They might do something different. This is the handouts they would get with it, but you just print off the website. This is some rhythm practice. That's singing the next song. And now we're going to sort of go through it. So the first thing is warm-ups. And they play this, and I don't think that plays actually. And this one, I don't have the sound on. But the idea here, and the kids can do this with the video at home, so it's kind of like being in a group class. So all we're doing here is balance work and physical work, and this is early level, pre-twinkle, and the kids are following, and we're doing just things to get ourselves ready to play. So I want them to have something that's physical. Some of it is not any instrument. We do later have warm-ups with the instrument. And now we're actually working with a woman who's a pianist, a dancer, and a Dallas person. And she is now doing a curriculum with us, and because we are not experts at this stuff, and she is, she's gonna be doing a whole sequence with us of physical, oral, tapping, clapping, non-violent stuff that's gonna plug into this in the later. So here, we're just working on shoulders and fingers and stuff like that. You get the idea. And so the warm-ups are kind of based on, some of them are left hand, some of them are right hand, and they come in here, and there's Sky, actually. She was just here. She's auditioning for Royal Conservatory. She helped me with this at one point. And then we have some Bowar warm-ups. So they have different warm-ups. And what you'll see in some of them is that there's a video for the student. So they can look on their iPad or whatever and do this for 2 minutes with this. Then there's also a pedagogy one where I'm kind of explaining it, which could be helpful for the parent. Because sometimes we say do this and they don't know what they're looking for. Or it could be helpful for the teacher. And some of them have lesson observations where we actually have us working with the child on that skill. They don't all have all three, but you know, we're kind of gradually.
That's kind of the first thing you're on about.
So here's my set.
And our pinky. Good. Now, without making a sound, we're going to lift our foot in the air and do a moon landing. Good. Now, going.
So the kid can like do this a little bit.
And see if it's straight. And let's lift our toe again. Take our whole arm and do a silent string crossing. We're going to drop our arm and go to the E string. E string.
Good. You see the kids when I do this, they do it. Yeah.
Move our whole arm back to the A string. A string. Let's do that again.
So you get that idea.
A string. Very good. Now, let's think of the proof. We're going to open our gate and do a marked proof from the middle to tip by E. So breathe with me. Close our gate.
You can see that breathing.
Middle two and three.
check in.
Cross over to the A string and let's do two A's.
Right, so I had showed, you know, we have friends looking at and colleagues looking at this, and one person who's not really a teacher said, well, they're kind of boring. The videos are kind of boring. And I said, well, we thought about that. I said, you know, it's not entertainment. You know, it's not entertainment. We actually spent time and we have made adjustments through our learning that you want them to kind of relax and zone. And you, my point in this is, you can tell kids to go home and practice markers and they go, bop, 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 okay, done. But when they stand in front of this, they actually do this, and they do the tapping, and they breathe. You just have to be careful not to be short enough. We're kind of getting down to what the timing is. And it's not the whole practice. This is just the support. So I had a little student, Leetan's son, bouncing off the walls in his lessons all the time. And I had him do one of these. And he's bouncing around because, you know, we're like testing it out. And he stands there. He goes, oh. And then it's over, and then he's bouncing around. But what was interesting, and his mom said, is that just, and even, she's a pianist, she's a musician, and she's a little bit like this, and they were fighting. And what happened was that it just gave like 2 minutes, because it controls the tempo, it controls the calmness of the voice, it's a reminder to do this. You saw even them. If I go like this, they go like that. You know, it's just like, it's like a yoga tape, you know. So this whole level then has, warm-ups, and then you can print out at every level. This is for the teacher. These are all the little things that were in all those warm-ups. So for instance, our group class teaches it, what we do, what I find helpful, even for myself, even though I did this. If I print this out and keep it in a notebook when I'm doing group class for that level, I can go, oh, yeah, let's do this today. You know, I just get you a list of warm-ups at this level that have value and could be fun. They don't have to be done in any particular order or whatever. But it's like if you develop a language with a bunch of stuff like this, and here's a left hand, right hand, bow arm, for this level, and you can just use it as a resource, and your kids can, you do them with your lessons, you know, it's not going to hurt them, let's just put that way. So then they have skills and drills. Here's an example, we're experimenting. We take the sound off. And they can still see the bow, but they play and they don't hear it. Repetition boring for you, good for them. So that's one thing we're working with. And then there's a bunch of little things like that. Then they have musicianship, and we're playing around with this. One is that they're gonna sing their song. I had a friend write different pianos. prep. And so what I'm doing with Road Trip is I'm having different pianists write, it's a trip, right? So we can go on a road trip and go to different cultures. And you're just playing on A and E. But we have a Gershwin, that was a Gershwin style, and we have somebody doing a fiddle one and someone doing sort of a jazzy one. So the idea is that they'll have exposure to different styles even though all they can do is play A and E. So that's the idea with Road Trip. And then, but the piano part I wrote with it, I'm writing something that I can play to start with, and that teachers who don't play the piano very well can play with their students. And then you have other people that can do other things. So they're hearing a kid and an older person play. Then there's a repertoire practice. Oh, wait a minute. I think we just did that. Go. I feel like we skipped something.
Let's play GDG.
Does this go back? No? Okay. Well, now I feel like I messed it up. Anyway, there's a repertoire practice where I kind of saying, okay, now put your A here and now go there. They get that. Then they have a performance practice where, I don't know what's going to happen if I touch that. Maybe it won't play. But basically, she's playing it and they can play along with a leader. But we're not using ourselves. We're using like teenagers, you know, because they're a little more relatable.
Let's play GDG, DAD.
This is a different. Do you all know GDG? It's just the bass line and the press buttons. We use this for beginning and to learn our strings. GDG. So that they're learning the oral of their string names and plucking and getting their arm around with its hot press buttons. And then they have a little music appreciation where they sing their next song, they see student performances of that, and then there's a little fun thing where we put a video up of something fun. So somewhere in Pizzicato we put a video of Pizzicato Polka, or there's a Gershwin version we put, you know, Rhapsody in Blue or something. We just pull something off of YouTube that's like real people playing, you know, to get them like a connection in some way to what they're doing. So, and then at the end, they have a home concert, so they can play for their family. And all it is really is the piano part. And they have a long, they go to play position, get ready. And so this way they can play for their family at home, even if nobody at home plays the piano. And it controls the tempo. So this is what we have. So that's just the piano part. So and then at the end is all of their songs and all the piano parts. So if they want to, they can do it. So in the process of doing this, like in the performance practice, we build in review. So they have their new song and they have the last song. And maybe the song before, and it starts slow, medium, and tempo, and it's kind of built in that the tempo gets faster. So the idea is that we're trying to get them to kind of do a little bit of a lot of these little things in their practice so that they get the idea that, and that the parents get the idea that all these things are important in their development. Does that make sense? That it's not just pushing your fingers down, but that all of these things are important. Then, at the next level, it's not micromanaged like this, because that's how development grows, right? We get broader and more independent as we go along. So at the next levels, when they're doing earlier concertos and things like that, this is just really kind of intended to be a support system. This is play this now, practice this now, do this now. Instead, the idea is, we have pieces and we're gradually adding to them that are just common teaching pieces, some skill development exercises, and so on. So I think we have some examples. Do you all know The Infant Paganini by Mollenhauer? It's a great little showpiece. So we teach that piece a lot. So we have a student playing it, because sometimes they can't find recordings or videos to listen. And when they go on YouTube, half of it is so bad. And I will be honest with you, doing this project, oh my goodness, I have found out, even from my own students, some of the stuff that's really been going on. Because when I started telling them I'm working on this project and you guys really go on YouTube, oh, well, really? And I said, just tell me. Just tell me. And I've had parents tell me, oh, you know, when you were doing spiccato, I didn't know what spiccato was, this is a mother. So I went on YouTube and I found all of these things, and they don't know what to look at. Or my kid is playing, you know, the swan, and they go listen to the kid playing it like this. You know, I mean, it's like there's so much out there. So partly what we're doing is very gradually trying to get our college, our former students or college students, to record some of these early intermediate little pieces in a musical, you know, just how they play it. It doesn't mean that's the exact bowing or fingering or bow distribution that we do, but just that it's a decent recording. And then we're giving some ideas. This is just an excerpt of it. So that gives you an idea. And then I actually have, I don't know if I have it up yet, but I have a whole page that has about 15 ways to practice that. Or, you know, 10 different ways to practice that. And the idea at this level is you have to give them so many ways to practice things so that, you know, they actually drill down. And then when they get to more advanced repertoire and they've done this kind of a section before, they'll have like a battery of things to do when they get to the more advanced stuff. And then same at the advanced level, it's just basically here's some ways to practice hard parts of the big pieces. And you might not think this is necessary, like if you're already an advanced independent player, but I find even in with these teenagers, a lot of them are playing big repertoire, but they still don't know how to practice, right? So we spend all of our time really helping them learn how to practice. So I'm just gonna give you examples. These are just more of the similar stages. So we took a little part of Brook Concerto, and we made like 5 practice pages on these, where we made it bigger, we made double stops, we do it in quarter notes so they can actually read it, because you know it's also squished up. And then we have 4 chords. Oh, I don't know why this isn't playing. I'm afraid to touch anything. Is there techie guys from here? Techie dude. I don't know why that's not playing anymore. I'm afraid to touch it. I'll let you know. Oh, well. Okay, we'll just leave it at that. So basically what she's doing is she's playing that chord progression and the notes are tracking here so that they can just hear the chords. I find that really helpful. And I'll skip that for now. But anyway, this has been really valuable for a lot of the kids that are using it. And I think helpful I'm finding it helpful because it's like one of the reasons I started doing this is I get sick of writing all this stuff out all the time. And every note that my student does, and now I can say, oh, here, go do this, go do this. And so we're gradually writing, even these little warm-ups, we're gradually putting them on paper. It's really hard to put them on paper, but I feel like if I have it there and I have a video, that when they go home, they can kind of internalize it a little bit better. The parents are finding, you know, like I said before, there's a part of me that hates the whole concept of practicing some of the video, because it's so personal. But it's just little pieces, it's not the whole thing. And for some of these younger families, it's just clarifying some things, giving them answers when they can't remember what they just saw, giving their child 1 minute to go do something with the tape while they're cooking, and they can see it at least forces them to play the song slower. You know, there are some things in there that have some value for some family. They're arguing less, actually. We're finding that a lot. You know, it just taking away some of that. And we're also finding that once a kid has done one of the videos a couple times, they don't need to do it every day. It's just like it's there, and it can be very personalized in the house. And for teachers, especially young teachers, it's helping organize the sequence and give them some resources. It actually is a membership site because it costs a lot of money to post all these videos and stuff. I'm not sure we're going to make any money off of it, but it just helps to allow us to do it. And but I made a code for you guys, so you can go in for free. It's just RCS 2016. So if you go in between now and February 1st, I think it's a month, you can just go in for free, and everything is there. All the sheet music is there. You can download. You can experiment. You can try. And just email me if you want a couple students to be able to try it out. Send me an email, and we'll work something out. Like us on Facebook. And there are also lots of free resources at the top that are not connected to those tracks. We're trying to put up gradually more and more performances of things, performances of common student pieces that you can go to, master classes, articles, links to other things, practice charts, repertoire sheets. There's a lot of stuff up there that's just out there. You know, I just tell my students to just go there. Any performance that's on there is probably okay, you know, if you're looking for things like that. We have some various different practice charts and repertoire things. Here's a violin choir repertoire list of some of our favorite pieces that we use. I'll just stop it. And that's pretty much it. So it just, I'm trying to just, over all these years, trying to make things functional. I think it's adaptable. It's adaptable. I view it as a resource, not as like, oh, you have to do exactly this. I view it as a resource. And I'm seeing people are using it in very different ways. And that's how I think it kind of should be. It should be. So I'm very open, maybe, you know, now is not the time, but later if I see you or you want to email me or anything, I'm really open to feedback and interested in feedback. And it might include, why would you ever do this? Or this doesn't seem right to me, or, you know, are you ever going to have that? Or, you know, anything. I'm really interested. And so we're looking right now at, you know, sometimes in our public schools, I don't know how it is here, but in our public schools in America, a lot of the rooms do have big TVs. And we're looking at distilling out a bunch of warm-ups that could be used with any repertoire to use as something that like kids could kind of do while teachers taking attendance. I know it sounds silly, but we've actually had that request. Could you make us a 5-minute warm-up video that we could do at our school? You know, so that I can like take these kids over here and do this and everybody else is occupied in some way, you know, this kind of thing. So we're toying with ideas of ways that we could pull out some of what we have or reconstruct some of what we have in a way to adapt to different, you know, different kinds of environments. Because that part is obviously, it's kind of geared toward more studio teaching, but we've had a lot of interest from people who are working in groups and also STEM programs and things like that to say, is there a way we can get some warm-ups that the kids can do? I'm also interested in getting more, like open string stuff with more variety in the piano parts and more, yeah, eclectic, fun stuff in the backgrounds that kids can do with it that still musically sound. Because there's a lot out there, some of it not great, and some of it, you know, valuable. But to me, it has to be pedagogically valuable and musically good. I don't care about the style, it can be hip hop or whatever. It just has to be like, you know, where you can hear your sound and want to play the good sound and open. So I'm looking to, we're looking to, along those lines as well as this.
Rebecca,